We're so glad that y'all are here today with us and got some familiar faces. We're low on this side. I guess y'all just, if Dick Small were here, he would have said the goats and the sheep, but we'll let him decide who all the goats are. I'm not going to call y'all that. But hey, we're so glad that y'all are all here. Thank y'all for being with us this morning. We're going to go ahead and jump right into it this morning. We have a little video for you today, and we'll get started. But thank you all for being here.
Let's have a word of prayer. Father God, we are grateful for this day that you've given us. We have the opportunity today to join together in song, to join together in worship to you and praise to you for all that you have done for us, for everything that you've provided throughout our lives, and as we look ahead as well. Father, we know that you're with us. We love you, Lord. In your name we pray. Amen. Let's all stand together and let's join in singing Faith of Our Fathers.
Faith of our fathers living still, in spite of dungeon, fire, and sword. Oh, how our hearts beat high with joy whene'er we hear that glorious word. Faith of our fathers, holy faith, we will be true to you till death. Faith of our unto thee, and through the truth that comes from God, mankind shall then be truly free. Faith of our fathers, holy faith, we will be true to thee till death. Faith of our fathers we will love, both friend and foe in all our strife, and preach thee too as love knows how, by kindly words and virtuous life. Faith of our fathers, holy faith, we will be true to thee till death.
Joel, have a seat. Let's continue worshiping the Lord with Leaning on the Everlasting Arms.
What a fellowship, what a joy divinely. on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace is mine, leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, how sweet to walk in this pilgrim way, leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, how bright the path grows from day to day, leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms. What have I to dread? What have I to fear? Leaning on the everlasting arms. I have blessed peace with my Lord so near. Leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. The everlasting arms. In times like these, you need a Savior. In times like these, you need an anchor. Be very sure, be very sure, your anchor holds and grips the solid rock. This rock is Jesus. Yes, he's the one. This rock is Jesus, the only one. Be very sure. Be very sure. And grips the solid rock. In times like these, you need the Bible. In times like these, oh, be not idle. Be very sure. Be very sure. Your anchor holds and grips the solid rock. This rock is Jesus. Yes, he's the one. This rock is Jesus, the only one. Be very sure. Be very sure. Your anchor holds and grips the solid rock. In times like these, I have a Savior. In times like these, I have an anchor. I'm very sure. I'm very sure. My anchor holds and grips the solid rock. This rock is Jesus. Yes, he's the one. This rock is Jesus, the only one. I'm very sure. I'm very sure. My anchor holds and grips the solid rock. There is coming a day when no heartache shall come, no more clouds in the sky. No more tears to dim the eyes. All is peace forevermore on that happy golden shore. What a day, glorious day that will be. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see, and I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by the hand and leads me to the promised land, what a day, glorious day that will be. There'll be no sorrow there, no more burdens to bear, no more sickness, no pain, no more parting over there. And forever I will be with the one who died for me. What a day, glorious day that will be. What a day my Jesus I shall see, and I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by the hand and leads me to the promised land, what a day, glorious day that will be.
All this week, we had Vacation Bible School, and so we thought it might be nice to have the kids come up and do the theme song, do the actions to the theme song this morning. So I'm going to ask the kids to come up. Everybody come up here on stage. couple of more worship songs. Thou art worthy, O Lord. Description too marvelous for words, too wonderful for comprehension, like nothing ever seen or heard. Who can grasp your infinite wisdom? Who can fathom the depth of your love? You are beautiful beyond description, majesty enthroned above. And I stand in awe of you. I stand in awe of you, holy God, to whom all praise is due. I stand in awe of you, and I stand in awe of you. I stand in awe of you, holy God, to whom all praise is due. I stand in awe of you.
I'm not going to tell you where to open your Bibles just yet after I get everything set up for us this morning, because I'm sure you'll read ahead and you'll already get what we're going to be talking about this morning. But let me turn this on. Get set up. But I can go ahead and tell you about this week. No, these were not all the kids that we had this week. We had 37, correct? 37 kids and teenagers this week for Vacation Bible School, and we had 2 salvations. Amen. And then we had 2 others that we're going to be following up with and having more questions with. But as I try to get this thing set up so I can do what I was wanting to do this morning, I apologize if you'll bear with me for just a moment. But Genesis, I'll go ahead and tell you, so turn with me to Genesis chapter 5, verse 21 to 24. And we'll ask the question, who is your daddy? As I wait for that, I will take up my seat and let you think about that for just a minute. Somebody said to Jeff this morning, we need couches like this. And he replied with, I'm sure everybody will fall asleep. And I responded with, more quickly, if we had all these chairs. But maybe some of you have that memory of your dad having that chair, that one spot that he was at. Maybe some of you had that memory of dad always being active and doing something, moving around, always into something. It may not work today. Maybe you had the memory of your dad always reading. Or maybe there was a memory of dad just not being there. Maybe there was a memory of dad just being ugly and mean. The world we live in, obviously, has good times, bad times, sinfulness. Sadly, the phrase, that's just the way it is one of the saddest things, because then it's just acceptance. Though that is a part of our lives here on this earth, apart from Christ, and it's very real, more so for some of us, and maybe even more of us, as I was speaking to some of y'all this morning, and I come to find out that there are more here that have a sad history with your father, or no history. And speaking to someone else and finding out that there was a great deal of hurt, bitterness, even abuse. And I want to preface all this with saying this. God loves you. He's the Father that will never mistreat you, never abuse you, never forsake you. He loves you unconditionally. And maybe you have men in your life that were more of a father than your, what we would say, earthly father, who really wasn't much of a father anyways. But we have these things that remind us of dad or our father, and is that how fathers should be remembered? As sitting in their couch, being gone, the ugly things and unkind things that come out of their mouths, the inactivity, not playing baseball with you, not doing any of those things with you, not having that relationship like a father should. My dad, I do remember sitting in a chair. Not that that was the only thing that I remember of him, but I do remember him being up early, sitting in his chair, and I mean early. He'd have a little lamp stand right here, little lamp, TV was over there, and on this lamp stand was a Bible and his daily bread, the little pocket devotional that he would read every morning, and then he would turn on ESPN. And then you'd see the first of what happened in the sports the previous day. But today is, and I jest a little bit with this, but it is, as I had shared, a real thing for a lot of people to not be able to honor a father, not to have that respect, or not to be able to because of so much hurt. But for some, there is a great deal of joy that you have from a father. Something worth celebrating. And the idea of celebrating Father's Day actually came many years ago. A Spokane woman in Washington named Sonora Smart Dodd, one of six children raised by a widower, tried to establish an official equivalent of Mother's Day for male parents. Let me just say about Father's Day, more to Mother's Day. You know what the number one celebrated holiday in the world is? No, it's definitely not Father's Day. Christmas is number one. Who can guess what number two is? Mother's Day. It's Jesus and Mama. Father's Day, number 20. So, 20, I can't think of 18 other holidays in between. Halloween is 6. And who knows what Arbor Day is? I didn't see what Easter, I didn't pay attention to what Easter was. But I mean, think about it. We're number 20. But at least Jesus won out and Mama's won out. But this Father's Day is, again, it was originally set up to as a way to honor fathers like mothers had their day. So this young lady went to local churches, YMCA, shopkeepers, and government officials to drum up support for her idea. And she was successful. Washington State celebrated the nation's first statewide Father's Day on June 19th, 1910. Slowly, the holiday spread, and in 1916, President Wilson honored the day by using a telegraph signal to unfurl a flag in Spokane when he pressed a button in Washington, D.C. That's neat. In 1924, President Coolidge urged state governments to observe Father's Day. However, it wasn't until 1972 that the day honoring fathers became a nationwide holiday in the United States under President Richard Nixon. It took that long for it to become a holiday. Today, the day is used to call Dad and tell him how much we love him and to thank him for all he has done. Maybe some of us, as we had said in the beginning, maybe our fathers have passed on. Maybe there's a sad history there. For that, we want to encourage you that you can remember, recall, and hopefully there was someone in your life that you could look to give that honor to as someone who was a father or who was like a father to you. This morning, we're going to do things a little different. And throughout the service, I'm going to have a couple people that I've already spoken to about sharing a Father's Day memory, as well as giving the opportunity for some of you that if you feel led to, you're absolutely welcome to share something. Either it could be of your father or someone who is more like a father to you than that should have been. But this morning, let's begin with our reading in our text. In Genesis chapter 5, verse 21, and the word of the Lord says this, "When Enoch had lived 65 years, he fathered Methuselah. Enoch walked with God after he fathered Methuselah 300 years and had other sons and daughters. Thus, all the days of Enoch were 365 days, or 365 years. Enoch walked with God, and he was not, for God took him." Right off the bat. Number one, if you're taking notes this morning, fathers, it's not too late to walk with God. And you're saying, well, I'm here in church. I'm here present. I've come to church this morning. This is me walking with God. And it doesn't, yes, and I'm very thankful that you are here, but that's not what it's talking about. This is a constant. This is something that was always for Enoch. He constantly walked with God. But look again, how old was he? 65. He was 65 years old. When his wife had Methuselah, and it says after he fathered Methuselah, he walked with God. So it was later on in life for him. It is not too late to spend time with God. And again, we're here in church. I'm glad that you're here. But this is a matter of the father should actively participate with God in scripture reading, in prayer, in worship, all those things, constantly, not just being here. It's not just being on here on Sunday mornings. It's not just being here on Wednesday nights with Brother Jeff or any other Bible study. It's daily. It's actively, all the time, so that you could be recorded as a man who walked with God. Is that how you'd be remembered, fathers? Or is that how fathers are remembered? Or are they remembered for being in their chair, watching TV, just being active, being nice, being abusive, being ugly, being absentee? The aspiration of a father should be to walk with God always. To be remembered as that. If I leave this earth and my family at the funeral service, one doesn't say, I can relax now, he's gone. Will they be able to say, he walked with God. He was a godly man. But it's not too late. One other thing that happened is he walked with God. There's a pace to being with God. It's not a rush. Yes, we've won the race, but in our relationship with God, it should be about taking time with him, having that pace of absorbing and taking the time to interact, not trying to hurry up and get through it. Let me just get through this God time of church or Bible study or scripture or prayer. Let me just hurry up and get done with it and be out of here. A father should never leave that as an example, be so rushed in life that they not take time to walk with God. This morning I had spoken with Katie. Where are you at this morning, Katie? I will come to you with this, and I would like for you to share what you have laid, what is laid on your heart about your father.
I don't know how to use those things.
Just hold it right there and they'll hear you.
Okay.
In his lap, us reading the Bible together. Dad was a worker in the refineries, so he did shift work. So anytime the church was going on, we were there. Even when he was supposed to be sleeping, we would be in the church, and then he would do his sleeping. We had, after the war, several of his brothers and sister come live with us. There was a lot of trouble after the war, and people were, you know, trying to get their foothold back in life. And he was one of 10 children. So there was a lot of times that we had people living with us, and things were a little chaotic, but my dad always had a prayer, and even if I thought it was boring and I didn't get my way because I was a one only child spoiled brat, he immediately would bring out what I should be doing, what Jesus would want me to do. And it was a very Christian household. Not that all my uncles and aunts were. I think sometimes they wanted to leave pretty quickly because Dad was always bringing up God and our lifestyle. And he was very quick to give a hand to anybody that needed it. There was a lot of times I saw him come home from work with 6 or 7 dozen eggs that for our family. And he always had a garden, and he shared that garden with everybody that he could. On Wednesday nights, sometimes they wouldn't have a preacher, and Dad would get up and give the message. So there were times in my teenage life when Shamedly, I did not follow Jesus. And believe you me, my dad was quick to tell me about it. He was. So I was very blessed to have a dad like that.
Thank you. It's extremely hard to see you saying that you were deserving of getting in trouble. I don't see that at all, or that you were spoiled. So I'll have you to not tell stories in church. So thank you, Katie, for sharing. But it's not too late to live up to those examples of being an honorable man of God and showing the world that we can be that. Number two this morning, fathers should be challenged to walk with God. Fathers should be challenged to walk with God. In verse 22, Enoch walked with God after he fathered Methuselah. There's something that happens to us whenever we become a father. At least it did for me. Because before, I think Haley would classify me as almost free-spirited. Not a hippie or anything like that. Not anything so weird. But I just didn't care. Not that I was disrespectful or anything. Nothing bothered me. Nothing worried me. I didn't stress. I didn't have anxiety. Didn't freak out about anything. And now that I have two children, I'm a spaz. Amen? But she's like, she doesn't want to agree in church because then y'all think bad of her. No, it's the truth. I'm telling you it's the truth. I'm the hover parent, not her. The boys walk out every time they go out in the front yard. What are you not supposed to do? Stay away from the road. If there's a dog coming in the yard, running the house. If there's a person walking down the street coming to the house, don't do this. Don't push your brother. Don't push him off the trampoline. Don't go near the water. Stay off the dock and don't play with electricity or anything sharp or pointy. Look, they're laughing, but it's true. If they were in here, I could tell them, what are you not supposed to do when you go outside? But there's something that changes in us whenever we become a father. At least it's supposed to be. God has gifted man and woman with the ability to create life. And likewise for mothers, as it is Mother's Day, but it's not y'all's day, it's our day. But, and women may think we're not very emotional, but we are. We just don't share it with y'all. But we do, at least I do, and I know of other men that I talk to that are so deeply concerned for the life and future of their children. But do they stop and think, am I living up to an honorable man that they should look up to, that they should see? And I'm challenged to do everything right because I don't want to walk through life and I get to the point where my children are playing baseball somewhere and they are just so skilled at it and they hit a home run and they get done and they get to home plate because I don't like football. They're going to get to home plate and that camera's going to be back there behind them. They're going to say, hey, Mom! No, they should say, hey, Dad. What? I'm just joking. But are they going to be able to look back and remember me as a godly man who helped them to become a fine godly man in their life? That's what I'm concerned about. That's what fathers should be concerned about and should be challenged to do. Hopefully my boys won't remember me as the hovering dad. I know it's true. I just hope that they don't remember me as that. But we have opportunity to give honor to our dads. I'm going to ask Mike Hale, as I spoke with him, that he would share. And then after this, I'll open it up to if anyone wants to share anything about their dad.
I'm blessed to still have my father. I talk to him every day. Every day. It's the same conversation every day. Did you go fishing? No, Daddy. It's 98 degrees. I ain't fishing in this. What'd you have for supper? Did you talk to the kids? But I'm blessed I can still do that. Doctor told him the other day he's got 23% of his heart working. So I'm blessed every day that I can still have that same conversation over and over. He's the reason I'm here at the lake, because I was raised at Six Mile Marina just about. That's where we went all the time. I never remember my dad spanking me. I knew he could. He'd come in there, me and my brother shared the room, and he'd come in there with that belt at night, and he'd slap that bed and say, "I'm going to tear y'all up." And we had a little chihuahua, and he'd come out from underneath them covers, going to eat daddy up. Daddy said, "I'll tear you up too." But mama died 6 years ago, and she was more or less in a wheelchair for the last 17 years, and daddy was there by her side every day, all night, as a caregiver. And I just hope and pray that I measure up to be the man that he was and still is.
Thank you, brother. Now I know he didn't whip you hard enough. I remember getting whoopings.
I am making
up for it. But as he said, to measure up to being half the man that he was. Fathers should be challenged to walk with God and to live up to that appearance, to that perspective. Number three, fathers should aspire for honor of being remembered as a man who walked with God. I've already mentioned this a little bit before, but would anyone want to share anything from about honoring their father or someone who was more like a father than the man who they called father? Yes, sir.
I hadn't really thought about my father in a little while. He's been gone for a good while. But when I think of my father, you know, the song, "On a Solid Rock I Stand," if I were to look at my father in one particular way, he would be that rock, okay? He was the rock of the family. He kept us together. My mother was kind of all over the place. She was kind of reminded me of me and Cheryl. But I hope I stand up to that standard anyway. But my dad was the one that, he was the solid rock. You could always depend on him. He was always there for me. He was a quiet man. But he did keep our family together. And like I said, he's just a solid rock. And I hope I can live up to what he had.
Is there anyone else that would like to share anything this morning? Yes, sir.
My name's Ron Mauser. I have attended here for several months or years, but I'm not a member here. But I want to share a little bit about a father that I wish everybody in this room would have had. My dad died when he was 52 years old. I was 21, freshly married, just had a grandchild. And my father was a very giving person. He worked hard. He loved his boys. He had four of them, one of which is Thomas, my brother that is a member here. And he always spent a lot of time. When he wasn't working, he was with us. And I can remember he protected his boys. He loved them. The one thing he always wanted was a daughter. He never got that daughter until I married this wonderful lady right here. And the thing he told us, he says, "I now have a daughter that I've always wished I've had. She's my daughter now." The other thing he told me when I was dating my wife, it says, "Son, the one thing you got to remember, to make a very good marriage, you have to put that person first. You come last." That's a very wise statement from a man that had very little education, but he had a lot of common sense. The other thing I can remember when I was much younger, I had a tendency of running off. I would run off and leave, and I may be going miles down the road, and my mother spent a lot of hours chasing me down and trying to find me, to the point they built a fence around the house, and I found a way of going under the house and going down the road and neighbors bringing me back with my dog Scamper. One day she pulled a switch and just whipped the heck out of me. And when my dad got home from work, saw all the stripes on my back, he told her, he says, "You ever touch him like that again, I'm going to spank you." And but he was very protective of his kids. And the one thing at his funeral, one statement that was made to me by one of his comrades in World War II, they were both in the Air Force in England, and he said, you know, soldiers got R&R occasionally to go in town and just relax and take it easy. My dad always gave his R&R pass away to other soldiers that needed it more than he did. So, you know, he was a very giving person. And the last thing I remember the most, or not the most, but he was always very proud of us. In high school, I played football. He was at that fence line every game I played, walking up and down along with those other dads. And if somebody said something negative about me, it was over. And he was always very protective. But I love my dad. I lost him when I was very young. There's not a day goes by that I don't think about him. And I'll be honest with you right now, I don't know why I didn't cheer up him saying this, because I do it every time. Thank you.
That sometimes those stories don't work out for some of us. It's very real. But thank God for people that stepped up to be that father. Right? I want to let Brother Jeff share with y'all as well.
Many of you know a little bit of my history, but my mother and father were divorced when I was still in diapers, and I didn't actually meet my dad until I was 8 or 9 years old. And I grew up because of the hardship that I saw that my mother was going through, because my dad wasn't there. I grew up hating my father, and it wasn't until I was in college that that I got over that I came to terms with that and was actually able to start liking my dad and then loving him. But while I was growing up, my uncle, my mom's sister's husband, my Uncle Bob, didn't live too far from us, and he took me and my two older brothers under his wing, and tried to teach us the stuff that normally a father would. How to work on cars, which don't come to me because I didn't learn a lot. Okay. The older one got that one, not me. But he encouraged us in all that we did, you know, whatever it was. And all three of us were so different. He was not. I knew that he was a man who loved God, who had a relationship with God, but he didn't ever go to church until later in his life, He was diagnosed with inoperable cancer. And at that point, he came to terms with the fact that he needed to get some things right with God, and he started to go into church, back to church at that point. And the last time that I ever got to talk to him before he passed away, I got to tell him how much he meant to me, that he was, I considered him much more of a father than my own dad. And he said, well, I always considered you boys to be my boys. You know, even though we weren't living together. You know, so when it comes to fathers, you know, when it comes to Father's Day, when I look back, I don't think about my dad, my physical dad. I think about Uncle Bob and everything that he meant to us.
Thank you. Is there anyone else who would like to share this morning?
Hi, my name is Mary, and I just want to say that my father passed away 2.5 years ago with leukemia. But 13 years ago, I was about to get married here in the church, and I came to this church because Norman and Barbara invited us to come to church. And so we were going to get married, and my mother died 2 weeks before the wedding. And so my mom, Barbara, stepped in and to help me, and my dad couldn't be here, so my dad, Norman, stepped in and took over. And my parents have both passed away, but I want to say, and Donna, too, she was my maid of honor. I mean, the whole church was here, and it was so beautiful. I mean, but, you know, my dad was busy over all the years, and I didn't always get to see him or spend time with him, but I adopted Norman and Barbara, my dad, here, and 13 years ago, and thank God he let me adopt him, because he's the best man on the face of the earth, and he's the best role model and Christian that I know, and I celebrate him today and every day because he's really been there and helped me through life, and one day I just hope to be half the person he is because he's the greatest, and I love you, Dad. So I'd be here all day if I told the whole entire story, but my mom passed away, and I tell you, this man, I love him to pieces, and I'm proud to have him as my dad.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
She had to slow me down because I was going to run her down the aisle.
That's right. He's mad, too.
Well, I couldn't ask for a better segue of how to end it. There are people. Oh, yes, ma'am. There's one more.
My testimony that I want to say today is not about my dad. It's about what happened when he died. My oldest son was in Germany in the army. He was out on maneuvers, and I called his friend to say that, to tell him that my dad had died, and the chaplain and my son's friend went out and got him. They brought him back to the base, and he called home. This is my son that was not involved in church. He went to church because we made him. And his first question to me was, Mom, do we know if Papa went to heaven? And I had to say, no, I don't know. And he said, well, let me tell you something. I'm coming home. But if anything happens before I get home, you're going to see me again. And I hung up that phone and I just danced around my kitchen. I was so happy that to know that I didn't ask my son. He told me, I want you to know that I'm saved and you're going to see me again. And I wouldn't take anything for that. My dad died 3 weeks before Father's Day. And on Father's Day, when everybody was talking about, what do you want, what do you want? I thought, I would like to know that my dad was saved. And I've always wanted to say this on Father's Day. Not to the children, but to the fathers. You can give your child a gift today. You can call your child and say, I'm saved, and I want you to know that I'll be in heaven for you. If you've never done that, please do that today, because nothing would mean more to your child than to know that they're going to see you again.
That's awesome. Thank y'all for sharing so passionately and from the heart. A few dry eyes. But thank God that we can share life. And one last thing, share of our lives. One last thing. We got people in this church. We have people in our communities. We have people in the area that one of the best ways you could show them Jesus is for a godly man to step out and take them as Uncle Bob, as Norm, as other individuals in our lives to show us Jesus. Men, here's your challenge. There's young men in this world, in our communities, in our neighborhoods, in our church that need somebody to walk up beside them and say, come on, I'm going to take you fishing. Come on, I'm going to take you to play baseball. Come on, I want to start reading scripture with you. I'm going to be praying for you every night. I want to pray for you now, et cetera, et cetera. But it takes a real man to do that. Can I pray for you? And we'll have a song of invitation if there's something on your heart this morning. As I said, we had two salvations this past week to celebrate. One of them is actually part of the church consistently with us. Another one's moved off to Bridge City. Had a couple other students that have questions that we're going to go back and speak to them more of it. But it's time to be serious. Just as my sister said a while ago, it's the best thing to be able to tell somebody, if we're gone from this place, don't worry, you're going to see me again. God, thank you for this time, and thank you for allowing us to be here and honor fathers. It may not be our dads, but a man that was a father to us. God, we thank you for fathers and the idea of what they should be. Like Enoch, a man who walked with you. God, my hope is that there are such men among us that death would not take them, but that you would bring them home just as Enoch. They wouldn't face the earthly death, but they would just be taken home. God, through the lives of fathers, we can experience Jesus, or we can experience hell. And I pray that we can experience more Jesus through fathers in this world. Father, we love you and ask that you bless this time of worship and song, and that you impress on somebody's heart for salvation, and you work in their lives. We love you and ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Softly and tenderly Jesus is calling, calling. praying for you and for me. See on the portals he's waiting and watching, watching for you and for me. Come home, come home. You are weary, come home. Earnestly, tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling, oh sinner, come home.
Y'all may be seated. Why is it on Mother's Day you always take Mother out for dinner, and on Father's Day you're always expected to cook barbecue? That's what I don't think is fair. I don't know. Anyway, all right. Other than the fact that we have no services this evening, so don't come back tonight. We don't have any services this evening. Why don't you spend your time with your families? But other than tonight, we're back to pretty much of our normal schedule. Wednesday night, we'll be back to having our children's activities and adult Bible study in here and youth activities. And then next Sunday morning at 8 o'clock, we've got Brotherhood Breakfast. Once again, make sure you take note of that, and there's some other things there in your bulletin. Take them, refer to them, because there's some things coming up that you might want to know about. Other than that, is there anything else? Anybody got anything? All right, let's stand, let's sing Family of God before we leave.
I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by his blood. Join heirs with Jesus as we travel this on. For I'm part of the family of God.